There's a thumbs up. Alan Parker, how you doing, Alan? Number of people watching this video is increasing. 10 people are watching this video. Well, that's good. Yes, yes, we're getting good on audio. I'm not gonna use the external mic on the iPhone. We're still working things out on this thing, so I'm not, I got two cameras. I got my my Panasonic that I'm used for putting the video up on YouTube, and I took the boom mic off of it. It had a shotgun mic on it because somebody told me it was picking up interference from the iPhone 5, which was sitting right next to it. And maybe it was the fact that it had an external mic running that was causing that. So we'll see. If somebody knows, let me know, because I don't know anything about this stuff. It's a weird glare from the lights over there. Let me try and point this a little bit different direction. Show you the table. Yeah, that helps a little bit. Let me close that door so we don't have so much light coming in from outside. It must be 10 o'clock because the air system just turned on for the test tank outside for the paint samples. Man, do I suck at electronics. So I need some help on it this morning. And if you guys can't figure it out, I'll post it up on YouTube this afternoon or in an hour or so and see if we can't figure this thing out. So let's not hesitate anymore. I'm going to try picking this thing up and moving it and showing you what's working. Maybe this will work, maybe it won't. I got power cords and everything plugged in. Let's see, I can turn this around. How's that shot? Can you see that, Betsy?
No, not yet. It'll take a while.
Okay, there we go. So here's what we got going on. This is an Arduino, and that is a relay bank. And there's 8 of them there, and they're all Arduino controlled. But there's a change I want to make to this that I need some help with. I finally figured out how to get this thing to work. It's kind of weird. These are low signals. So what it does, it actually connects. If you just connect the ground to any of these pins, it pulls that pin low and turns that relay on. So the Arduino is just running some code to turn 4 of them on, then turn 4 of them off after a little pause. And the Arduino is getting its power through this line, which through all kinds of wire harness here is getting it from that this LiPo battery. And I don't know if this is a, they go by S sizes, but you know, they don't ever put the S on the thing. I think it's a, if it's 11 volts, what is it, guys, an S3? It's 3 batteries actually in here. It seems like it's more packs, or, you know, they put them in series and then parallel. So anyway, I don't like that S dig thing, but anyway, that's how they talk about almost time. That's 11 volt. And what we're going to do is we're going to put a whole bunch of those in, so that's what the other connectors are here for, in parallel. So we'll all always have 11 volts, but a lot of it as far as amperage goes. So anyway, Arduino's getting power from there, and it's controlling this. But see, the problem is the Arduino is also powering these the coils on these relays, and I don't want that to be the case, because there's 8 of them here, and then there's another 8 at the other end, and I might put another 8 in and that's just too much power to ask this Arduino to supply all that. So I need to figure out a way of powering this thing. I think it has something to do with these little jumpers over here. If anybody's familiar with this 8 relay module, that's what I need to know about. Is it on the shot for the
little white thing? Is, yeah. What is that tick, tick, tick?
That's what the you're hearing the relays click on and off.
Oh, there are, it's always 3?
4. See, it's always 4. Because trying to do the LEDs, the drivers. I got another question about those too, but this one first. So what it does, it puts a, it turns on a coil here, which is a magnet, and that pulls over, mechanically pulls over a big switch, which can control the power for the, in this case, we're using the to control the power for the power supply, and then power the LEDs. And so what I have here is from this thing, which is not on, this will provide the power for the LED. So there's all the grounds wires going in, and then all the hots come in, they get spread out through here. And then as a relay comes on, that hot gets connected to its particular power supply. So let me turn this on, you'll see what it does. So see, there's the LED lights on and off. So that's powering up 3 of these. It's actually powering up all 4 of them, but I burned out one LED. So Yeah, it's dead. But you know what? This is such old technology. We'll get to that. So anyway, what I need to know is how do you power, and I think it has something to do with this. This says GND, which is, I know is ground. It's got three pins here and a jumper. And if I pull it off, it goes completely dead. So it's got VCC to, it looks like JDVCC or ground. And there's not a really a PDF or anybody that really explains how to power this board, but I'm sure there's a way of powering this from the 11 volt. And I know it only takes 5 volts to do that, but we have these little gadgets, and they are a voltage.
Show me the gadget.
Here, it's coming up here. Can you see it?
Yes, okay.
This is a DC to DC converter. And all it is you have two wires coming in, two wires going out. This one has its wires going out soldered on too. And it's got a potentiometer there that has it's a multi-turn. And so you can crank it down until you're getting a known voltage on the outside. And that's really cool because I checked it with putting 12 volts in as well as 11 volts in. And I had the out set for 5 volts, and it didn't matter about the 1 volt change on the input side. It held with the 5 volts on the output side. So, pretty impressive little gadget. Anyway, that is what I have. I'm thinking about, you know, pulling that off of my batteries and then powering this with the 5 volt that needs, but I don't know where to plug that in. I tried doing a few things yesterday, didn't work. Fortunately, I didn't blow up my, this is an Arduino Mega. It's one of the old ones, the 2560.
Do you know the serial or the full name of that relay board, please?
Yeah, it doesn't have a, you know, that's kind of funny. All it says is 8 relay module. If you Google that, you get it. There's some...
That blue thing?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's it. That's the blue thing. I put tape on the backside to protect the contacts there. But you Google 8 relay module, you'll get it, and you'll actually find some guys. And there's one, even a YouTube video of a guy who's wired this. I know it can be done because he wired it. He said it, he did. He said it has too much amperage to power off the Arduino. So he wired his separately, but he didn't say how. It's a great little video. You'll find it on YouTube if you just, you know, look at that 8 relay module Arduino as your search.
Do you have the wiring diagram written out?
Yeah. Yeah, there's a wiring diagram written out. No, I've started on one a couple times, but no, not really. We're kind of making it up as we go along. You know, I don't know that I can power that off of this 5-volt DC to DC. If I can, that'll be part of the wiring diagram. If you guys want to, somebody wants to come over here and be my secretary, there'll be a wiring diagram.
Herb wants to know, and Herb's coming.
Herb, you got a job, Herb, okay? Yeah, you are coming. So yeah, you can knock yourself out documenting anything you like, and then we're gonna go and change it. So you'll have to come back every week to update it. Let me sit the camera down so I can get a drink of tea. Yeah, okay, straighten the camera up a little bit. Turn this around so we can see what's in the picture. There's Betsy over there. Wait, Betsy. Let's see, I wanna talk about LEDs. I am not, you know, there's been a lot of cool stuff out there on LEDs with homemade flashlights. And I have the LEDs that I'm using are a couple of years old. So I don't think, I think we can do better, you know. If you go to our website, svseeker.com, you'll find in the menu, you go to ROVs, and then Toad Sonar ROV is a link. Or a menu option, or Bob. Bob's an old one. If you want to build one with your kids, Bob's a great one to look at. The first one is this one. And you go over, you go down to lights, and you'll find these drivers. I got them. I think I paid $85 for this driver and an LED. Let me find the LED. I got a bad one right here somewhere. Isn't it amazing how things just disappear? When you know they're right there in front of you somewhere. Okay, it's gone. Well, I'll bring the cameras over. Hopefully the power cables will stretch this far, or I can unplug you. There we go.
While you're moving,
yes?
Constantine says there's probably an array of opto-isolators.
Yeah, there are. This is an opto-isolated board.
Have you measured the current draw?
Hell no. measured current draw on the optic. So they were, I know it's bad just by taking someone else's word for it. It's going to be too much because you got to think about it. I'm planning on running three of these things off this. So that's, you know, we need another way of powering these things for the coils. And yeah, they are opto-isolated, but still that whole, that board and those coils have to be using the voltage coming from the Arduino. So yeah, I don't know what they draw. There's the LEDs, and I have them. These are the old ones, and they have a focusing lens that we messed with. It helped a little bit. That has a bump basically on top of every of the each one of the diodes in that LED. Now they're making them so there's just one big one in the center, which is going to be beautiful. If we want to put a focusing lens over it, it'd be a lot easier to do. And I'm not even sure that we'll do it to start with. Here, now they're powered up. You see what we're talking about there. And those are supposed to be 1,000 lumen. I doubt they are because they came secondhand from China, which means they're Cree probably, but they're probably something that Cree threw off into the seconds and thirds bin. But now they have LEDs that are doing like 100 or 2,000 lumen, and I don't know if they are or not. But I don't know if I can drive, you know, just the new, the Cree has a new one out. I'll show you it in a little bit. I don't know if I can drive it from these modules. These things are taking in 12 volt DC, and they're putting out 34.5 volt DC. And it has something to do with constant current. You know, somebody that knows more about it will be able to explain that in the comments section. Please do so. But what I'm really looking to do, because $85, I think these can be bought now for, you know, a fraction of that. And I think they can be smaller. And so that's what I want to do. I want to find a new set of LEDs that are, you know, brighter. I don't, that'd be all right. And this unit smaller would be great. Somebody also has warned me that, and it's true, these heat sinks are actually part of the circuitry. They had a little bit of voltage on them when they were powered up. It was only like 3 volts, but still a little bit. So I'm going to have to isolate them from each other and from the hull, which is not a big deal. I got some Kapton tape coming along that I'll just put a strip of Kapton tape along there. It'll take the heat. So if we need to take care of that, that's no big deal. But that is the part of the trick. It's got to be able to fit inside of a 3.5-inch ID pipe. And these do, so I'm figured anything new, is it all gets smaller. In fact, it's kind of beautiful because the cameras that we're using on the ends of the ROV, every time I buy them, it's the same camera, these gadgets. It's always the same camera, but they always get a little smaller and the boards get a little smaller. So it's now, at first I used to mount the board for this one on the back and separate it with this ribbon cable. I don't even have to do that anymore. So life is good. It's all getting wonderful and that things get smaller. Let's see, I had that in the last video, but there's our setup and Drew's a thruster. This is like the one we're gonna use. Just love that. Let's see. So, and oh, I wanna show you that Cree. Let me unplug the power here. And
I have some questions.
Turn your volume down there so I don't get feedback on that. I want to show this video and video and video. There it is. That is a Cree. What does that say? X lamp. MK-R LED 600K. That's how.
6000.
6000K. That's just how. That's just saying that it's like the sun. 15 watt for flashlight torch lamp DIY. I don't know, but look at the price of that. $37 for 5 pieces. So, geez, they certainly have gotten nice. You know, we're hoping to build this whole ROV for under $5,000. If we wait long enough, you know, that'll definitely be able to happen.
I have a couple of questions.
Yeah, go ahead. I'm done. I'm done rattling on for a bit.
You might have answered some of these. So how much heat are those things putting out? I think I'm not sure, Herb, if he was asking about the LEDs or those or your little metal
doobadovers. Yeah, I'll answer both that way. The heat sinks don't put out hardly any at all. I don't plan to have the LED lights on a lot. There will be times where we're probably doing a search run where we're running a lot of LED. The lights themselves are out in the water. The way we take care of that, and we've already tested it, and it worked fine on these versions, is we just pot the whole LED in silicone, And it's a really thin silicon, so it gets in nicely. We even put it in a vacuum chamber, which is not a problem to do. The thing I've learned, though, is I need to run the silicon out over the side of the LED itself. All right, find that one that was laying around here. I will show it to you. It's worth one more look around the shop.
Okay, in the meantime, how many amps are your drivers?
Have no idea.
Okay.
Oh, look on the web page, and they're there. There's the specifications for them are copied and pasted there. So the LEDs themselves will be potted in silicone, and I'm going to wrap it around the edges because it would peel from the edge of that one that's no good. So I'm going to wrap it around. I may encase it completely because the silicone transfers, it's going to be so thin that it'll transfer the heat pretty well. But the deal is we just put the whole thing out in the ocean water, and we've done it in our test tank. It worked fine. And we've even pressurized them to 2,000 PSI, and they came back and worked fine. So we're happy with putting the LEDs right out in the water. That eliminates us having to build a housing for them. If we have to build a housing, we'll do so later. But, you know, my engineering approach is don't do it until you prove that you have to do it. Otherwise, you're just wasting time and money.
Jim has a suggestion here.
Yeah?
He recommends using a PIC instead of an Arduino.
Oh, I don't care about that. I picked Arduino because it's widely used. Everybody has them. Everybody knows them. We're going to keep it simple to start with, and then we'll grow into whatever we need to go into. You know, eventually it's going to be a full onboard computer on this thing because what we want to do is get rid of the cable eventually. So we'll step up the controller for, you know, for me and for anybody else that's just starting out. Arduino. I mean, I wouldn't push anybody. I could probably be more comfortable with an SBC, a single board computer, than I am an Arduino because, you know, it's where I work. But for everybody else, and it's not that hard to learn, Arduino is definitely where we're going to start with. Now, we'll move on up to different levels and a PIC controller. I don't even know if that's even more powerful.
No, PLC.
PLC?
Not PIC.
Oh, PLC is programmable logic controller. That's what's used in manufacturing. They're too damn expensive. No, screw that. Anything that's related to, you know, anything you get from West Marine or, you know, it says marine in front of it or industry, the price is way on up there. You know, for building a unit that you're probably going to lose in a fishing net at 1,000 feet, no, we're going to keep it as cheap as we possibly can. So that's the direction. And then move up as we absolutely have to. Again, you know, once you have established a need that you need more power, then you move to more power. To start off there, not necessary. If somebody else wants to build this unit and just use it in a lake, then, you know, an Arduino will probably be more than enough power. You know, while it's tethered and everything with the control up top, there's no point in it.
Jim says these are $100. I'd say, Jim, why don't you email Doug?
What's $100?
Those PLCs.
Yeah, and an Arduino costs what? You can buy them for $15. So I've got your price point beat a little bit. Now, if you want to send me one, yeah, sure, I'll look. No, I don't even want to send it. Because see, the idea is we build these units cheap so that other people can build them cheap. So looking at something expensive, I know, you know, when it's something that, you know, if you were asking me, well, which database should I use, Microsoft SQL or Oracle? It's like, I'm going to say Oracle every time. Because I'm an Oracle database administrator, it's what I know. You know, I could do it in my sleep at this stage of my life. And so everybody's like that. So you gotta think about it, you know, where are my biases? And if I worked with PLC all day long in a factory, heck man, I'd say PLC too. But for everybody else on the planet, no, there's just dumb. You look at anything look at these relays and you'll find a number of little tutorials that an eighth grader could get through. Maybe even a sixth grader could get through on these, putting these things together, and they do. So Arduino is definitely the way to go. The cheaper, the dumber, the more widely available is the route we'll always pick. The heat, I didn't finish the heat. The drivers, these things really don't get that hot. And they put them in flashlights, so you can't get too hot holding it in your hand, right?
And how hot are the LEDs?
The LEDs get super hot. But putting them out there in the water, directly exposed to the water, you know, we'll have it, we'll know better than, we'll turn them on as a test in the dry. We don't run the LEDs lights unless the thing's sitting in the water because it just doesn't have a heat sink.
Charles Cox says...
Hi, Charles.
He says, the way I've seen those relay boards hooked up, the 5-volt power supply controls the relays and you can run a separate 12-volt that is controlled by the relays. So the 5-volt
Okay.
There's a relay on, which allows the 12 volt to move to the lights, I think.
Well, I don't follow that, so what I need is a drawing. Okay. Put the pins on, put the wires on, just scratch it out on a napkin, be fine. And take a picture of it, post it, and that'll be the best way to do it. If you don't, you're on Facebook if you're watching this now, so put it up there, and that'll let me know, because I'm not an audio guy, I'm a visual guy.
Now, Daryl's having fits because you're flip-flopped again, you know?
Flip-flopped what?
Well, you know, because of the way the phone is.
Oh, yeah.
We're looking at it like that.
Yeah, it's funny.
And he sees it.
If you think it's weird for you, I think it's weird for us, too, because I see one camera shows me the room one orientation, and the other one shows the other orientation. So,
however, the one
that's why iPhone does that
after the fact on YouTube.
Yeah, it'll be right again. So, if you see this on YouTube, you're going to see it from the Panasonic camera, which is correct. But if you see it from iPhones, you know, I got it flipped so that I can see the iPhone screen, so I can actually see, you know, comments on there. Wiring diagram, laughing out loud. Yep, I have. Yeah, yeah, you'd have a lot of work to do, Herb. It depends. And the audio will be better and the picture will be better, all because I'm going to actually post it from the Panasonic.
Boy, that's a nice shirt you have.
It is a nice shirt.
Turn it around so they can see it backwards.
Yes.
There you go.
Yes. It takes a little, you know, it's good to, for your ego to wear something that's a little self-deprecating every once in a while. It keeps you in line here. And I don't claim to be a welder.
So. That's probably our number one best-selling shirt.
It is, yeah. The gray. I think people buy them and give them out to people as gifts.
And for less money, we do have the hat.
Yeah, you have a cap too, so yeah, we'll do a little merchandising. Anyway, that's what I'm doing today. I'm also working on. Well, it's a little far off, but I'll show you the next thing that I'm messing with right now. Here, I'm gonna take off power supplies again and walk you over here. The next thing is. We switched. Look at that. Look at that little tiny. That is an ESC, and it's a reversible ESC. It's an auto one. It's for cars. And I went through programming it, which is, you know, listening to all the beep sequences. And it's kind of like easy Morse code. But anyway, you turn the controller one way for yes and the other way for no to answer all these questions that comes out through it. And once you get them all answered, then you've got this thing programmed. So I got it programmed where it kind of works. Let me turn it on and run it for a little bit. Let's see. I'm going to pull the power on the Arduino, so we just shut that down. There we go. And let's see. I think I've got it programmed, so all I got to do is turn it on here. And the on switch works here, so I thought about using that on the relay. But when I overrun the engine or get it to jam somehow, the ESC doesn't reset when you push that button. So I am going to have to be able to power down the ESC. So that's going to go through one of these relays too. So there's two of them down here, two of them in the center, and two of them at the other end. So six of these relays are going to be used just for powering off ESCs. And they say they pull like 20 amps, and this relay is only good for 10, but we're not going to do any big pushes like that for very long. So I think everything will be all right. If not, then we'll have to change our relays out to something like I've got some of those big, heavy, and we may go with those anyway. I got some of those big old jumper, what do they call them? Can you scoot? I gotta look in here. Yeah, no, they're not in here. I don't know where they are. I have to go looking for them. Solid state relays, that's what I'm trying to remember. I got some solid state relays that we may use for the ESCs instead. But anyway, I got this working so that motor there can run. I think that's one direction, and there's the other. But see that? When I turn it up too fast, it locks, it stops, and everything goes dead. See that? The ESC has no lights on it now. And I gotta turn this off and nothing happens. I turn it back on, nothing happens. It's using the battery eliminator circuit from the ESC for power. No, it's not. I'm using my LED. I'm a 9 volt there. Huh. So if I see, we're just dead in the water. And the way to reset it, unplugging that, plugging it back in, doesn't do anything. I have to actually unplug the battery, which would be a relay in the future, right? And plug that back in. And then it comes back to life. It's all happy again. Ain't that weird? I wonder if it even needs this, because I...
Could be an overpower shutdown.
It is. I think it is. But, yeah, see, I'm not using my 9-volt. It is using the battery eliminator circuit. It is. It's some kind of an overpower shutdown kind of thing. And I'm not sure if it'll be a problem in water, but it certainly is in air. But it says that this little switch, which I have other ESCs I've been using, and this switch didn't work at all. At least it works on this one. It will, if it's listening to you, see, it will power it down and power it back up. So it would be kind of cute if that would work. But since I can put it in this state where it's overpowered or something, it's got a fault on it. And the only way to reset it, apparently, is to shut the power down to the ESC. Then I've got to use my relays anyway.
Let me put something out, okay? Yeah. You're looking... You're framing this in your video camera, which is above the phone.
Yeah, so you can't see anything. So I need to hold high a little bit.
So for those people who can't see it, if you come back later and watch it on YouTube, you'll be able to see everything clearly.
Yeah, that's a good point. The YouTube video will be better, because these two cameras are... I just got a rubber band on here. So let me show you that old ESC. I think I know where that is. There it is. There's one. See, that's the old ESC that we had on there. And this one's supposed to be able to
lower
do
two.
Lower two. Yeah, further out.
There you go.
There we go. So this is the old ESC. And it's bigger, it's hunkier, it probably does a better job. It takes a lot of programming too. But I figure if we can use the cheaper, smaller one, then that's what we're going to do. Remember, we're building something to be lost in the ocean. So,
is there a way you could make the thrusters? I'm thinking you're meaning thrusters.
Thrusters?
Charge the batteries.
Oh, yeah, we actually looked at that. Yeah, so you could actually tow the ROV and it would turn into the blades. You could only do that on these motors here. The problem is you got to spin that blade really fast.
We can't see what you're pointing at.
Yeah, okay, I'll show you.
We did those blue robotics.
Well, things. Yeah, I'm pointing it like this will work. So you got to, it takes a lot of force to overcome the magnets here. It probably could be done, but it's just not worth it. We're not maybe with a special built one at some point in the future, but the whole idea is to probably get away from ROV and get AUV as soon as, you know, we can work that far up, which will take a while anyway. So I'm not really interested in chasing rabbits that aren't leading down that pathway.
Jake said if the current draw is too high, there are sometimes polyfuses that fuse to protect the battery.
Okay. And unfortunately, you got to power off the whole damn thing to reset them. Is that right? Okay. Any other questions? Are we done for now?
For that?
No, I'm done. I can
Well, somebody had a question about the boat.
Okay.
Why did you choose the Chinese junk?
Oh, okay. We'll do some of those questions now. But I really want to get this video posted and read your answer, because I'd like to work on this thing today. Got a long way to go. I only got, how far into February are we?
You have about 3 weeks.
I've got three more weekends to get. Oh, I want to get all this thing wired together. What's that?
You've been at night.
Yeah.
Here.
Yeah, we've been working pretty hard on it, but I'm not good at this, so it's not going to be fast. And I'm trying not to smoke too many things. Man, I don't want to smoke another camera. Jeez. Anyway, the question was...
Chinese junk.
Chinese junk. Why did I choose Chinese junk? Don't really care about Chinese junk. I mean, it's a cool boat. It's fine. I mean, what makes it a Chinese junk? It's got a big flat transom in the back end. It's got a little, you know, wide spot in the front. Other than that, it's just a twin-keeled vessel. I chose features about it for specific reasons. I chose something that could carry a lot of weight. We can put 20 tons on that thing. It'll be fine. We can spread cargo out on the deck if we wanted to. I chose it for that. You can't put a lot of weight onto a catamaran. Catamarans was my first choice, because they go fast, they're cool, great boats. I believe that there's a purpose and a function for every boat that's out there. And every boat out there has, you know, great abilities. I'm going to turn this off because it's annoying. My wife sits there and beats at me. So we got a big steel hull because a mono hull because it can carry a lot of weight. We got twin keels because I want to do the maintenance ourselves. I don't want to rely on marinas and haul outs and that sort of thing. I'm going to sail down to the place where it has a big tide. We're going to park that puppy, let the tide go out, and do whatever work we need to on the bottom of the hull. Twin keels lets us do that every tide change. We don't ever lean over the side. We don't have to put poles down to stabilize us. We don't have to tie up to a wharf or anything like that. We don't have to rely on other people. We could do it out anywhere. Well, that has a nice tide and a nice bottom. Not hard to find, actually.
Usually, isn't it cold?
Yeah, but then the water's gone. You're not that cold.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so. Well, I mean, England's got these atrocious tides. Places in Alaska do. Even the north...
east?
The west. The northwest. They have these... I can't remember what they're called. Somebody will tell me. They have... You go into their up to their marinas, their docks, especially their commercial stuff. They'll have like railroad ties. They're bigger than that in most cases, laid out on the down in the water, and that's so you can park your boat and let the tide go out, and then they can go out and work on their keels. So their tides are I don't know, they're upwards of 8 feet. We just need 6, and we can get the whole boat dried out. We don't need that much to work on the cutlass bearing. We could pull the drive shaft out, put a plug in there. You know, if the tide's coming back in, wait for the next tide change. Go back out and finish working on the cutlass bearing. So, and we get to scrub the hull by standing on the ground, which is much easier than scuba diving. In the Bahamas, though, it's like the water temperature's great. Just everybody jump out there and do, you know, 3 feet of the hull.
And benefit of the sails?
The sails are were chosen. They work out great to be jumped to because they're unstayed. Unstayed means it's just one steel pipe. There's no guy wires coming down from that pipe to the boat. That means you can walk down that deck and not crang your, open your skull up hitting into a stay, which is a steel cable. That's called standing rigging. And there's running rigging and standing rigging. Standing rigging is the stuff that doesn't get changed while you're sailing. Everything else is lines that control the sails, stuff that moves about, that makes things move. So there's none of that standing rigging on an unstayed mast, because there's no stays. And the deck crane that will sit up there can swing around, and we can drop stuff in and out of the water. So it's a lot like having a motorboat out there with, you know, because you don't have all that crap down the sides of your decks, chain plates and standing rigging and all that, that gets in your way. So that worked out beautifully for us.
Now the downside.
Downside? Sails like shit. If you're going to race, you know, actually they come in pretty good, well, in the races. You can do different things to the sails. The sails are old school. They sail like we sailed back in the, oh geez, well, I mean, the I just finished listening to the book 1421. Yeah, the year China discovered the Americas. It's a great book. I mean, it's one of those things like, yeah, maybe, maybe not, but the evidence is fantastic. Go through, and it's a great lesson in geography too, which I'm bad at geography. Not as bad as electronics, but I'm bad at geography. The great book. They sailed with current and wind. They didn't have keels on their boats back then. Not real. The Chinese junks were kind of flat bottomed, right? They figured out a lot of things, but they didn't figure out the keel. But it didn't really bother them, because what they did is they ran these routes. They just waited for the wind to change, or they, you know, would do this. They would do these loops around following currents and wind, which is, you know, the equatorial is the doldrums. And anyway, you can look at a map of it. The with keels, we can do better. Will we ever beat a Marconi rig or a Bermuda sloop beating into the wind? No. There's no way in hell we'll beat them. Now, downwind, yeah, we could probably pass them, because we got more sail area, and we're not having to worry about, the form of your shape of your sail doesn't matter then. You're just trying to go downwind. They can't even open their sails up all the way out to the side. We can, because we got no standing rigging. There's no shroud lines that prevent us from doing that. So, yeah, we kick ass. But then, not really, because we got a big shroud around a propeller, and we got these the stays for the shroud around the propeller. We got a lot of wetted surface out there. We don't have a bow thruster. Bow thrusters do slow you down. That's not why we don't have a bow thruster. There's certain things they do. So what she do is she was like, you know, if you really want to go fast around the world, you got to put a lot of money into a boat that's extremely lightweight, extremely expensive to maintain. I mean, not just purchase and build. So if you want to go fast, it's like, geez, why did you pick sailboats? Get an airplane, right? You can build those in your home, too. I mean, you go a hell of a lot faster than anybody will in a sailboat. So, you know, sailing is, to me, is not, I'm not in it for the sailing. I'm really in it for the adventure. And so sailing like they did in the 1800s is something I want to do. It's not something you want to do. Don't build this kind of boat. You know, build a Marconi rig, build something that's nice, long and skinny, and go fast and knock yourself out. But, you know, there's all kinds of boat out there and all kinds of people, and this is the boat from this kind of person.
Yeah. Here's an interesting little bit. It's kind of a long-winded question, okay, or a statement.
Go ahead.
But it's more about going back to the ROV.
Okay.
how many ROVs, now let me do the whole thing. How many ROVs do you expect to be built by other people, not by Seeker's crew? From my perspective, I don't see many because it's a highly specialized piece of equipment, not a toy that people are building for fun. So my concern is you focus too much on the open source and availability instead of focusing on parts that... I guess he ran out of words.
I get the gist of the question.
Okay.
Instead of parts that are really proven that they're going to have a high reliability, like PLC and industrial things.
Because that's not the world I want to build. That's the easiest question,
but
answer
the cost,
to it.
Cost, you want to keep the cost down because?
Well, I'm going to lose the damn things. I mean, I plan to, if you have an expensive piece of equipment, if I have an expensive piece of equipment on my boat, you know, it's like when I was in Africa, there's this thing of scarcity of resources. You know, it's like if you don't have very many of them, you don't use the ones you have. I found a closet that had all kinds of computer supplies in it one day. I was like, oh, Mecca, finally, you know. So I started unloading it, and immediately I was pounced on by the vice principal. I was like, what are you doing? So I'm taking this up to the lab so we can use it. So those are the only ones we have. why'd you get them if you're not going to use them, you know? So I want to have an ROV that is cheap for me. I don't expect this thing to not get lost, especially when we cut the tether and we start letting this thing wander around on the ocean on its own. There's going to be days it doesn't come back, you know, and it's like, it's, you know, Sally's way overdue. It's something bad has happened. You don't want to I can't afford, nor can my donors afford to lose a $10,000 piece of equipment in those events. And, you know, you're saying, well, nobody else is going to build this. Actually, you don't know that. You know, that's not the world I see. I see the world becoming more adventurous and more, what's the word I'm really looking for? Inquisitive. And that's the world I want. And so I build for that world. If that's not the world that materializes, so be it. But I'm going to have the positive outlook, not the negative one. So there's the quick answer.
I think we have a newbie on here.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
You asking about bow thrusters?
Yes, Bob asked about... he said...
Bow thrusters? Well, he could be joking, too, because it's become a joke.
So he said, have you thought about putting a bow thruster to help in maneuvering? In a slight breeze, the wind will move you, and with only one engine, you might have a problem in docking. It's just a thought.
You know, Bob, they sailed around the world in the 1400s, and they didn't have bow thrusters. You know what? They didn't have engines, either. So it can be done. And, you know, it's not for everybody to live without the conveniences of, you know, radar and bow thrusters and, helicopter pad and what?
How much do you dock, too?
Yeah, that's
it. You're not going in.
If we were going to run a day charter, you know, where we're up to the dock three times a day, you know, in and out, various weather conditions, it doesn't matter about what the wind or the current's doing at that moment. It's your guests that are getting on the boat. I would have a bow thruster, because that's just so... And if we're maneuvering inside marinas around these mega yachts, oh my God, I'd have a bow thruster, you know? I'd be paranoid even then. I'd have a stern thruster, too. I don't want to do that, so I'm not going to build the boat that lets me do that. I just don't care. We're going to be the boat that's anchored out. We'll be at the fuel dock, but we'll do it when the weather's and tides are nice and the fishing fleet's already gassed up and gone for the day. We'll do it, we'll drop our tender into the water if we need an extra hand, and we probably will, and use it as a barge. It'll be built so they can just be run into the boat and push or pull, whichever way.
So yeah, I'm not going to be doing a lot of close quarter maneuvering. My point is to avoid that. I would love to, you know, when I was in Florida, I saw several places where these old docks that are just, they're gone. They're just some pilings there now. You know, that place, and it had currents that just ripped around the corner there every once in a while. I would love to find a place like that and just hang out there for a week and do nothing but maneuver up against those piers until I can do it even at night, you know, by just looking at the current. And, you know, I want to be that kind of a sailor, but I'm certainly not going to do that learning in a marina. And even then, if I get really good at it, I'm not going to do that in marinas because I just plan to avoid marinas. They don't give those things. They don't give you dock space for free. But they don't mind. They don't charge hardly anything for a mooring, or often it's nothing for dropping your anchor even in the harbor. So that's where we'll be. And then we'll drop our tender in the water and we'll zip off to town to get supplies. That answer the question, I think?
I think so. Charles Coxey sent you several things.
Hey, Charles.
The thing is, we aren't really going to know what these look like until after we get off of here. So,
Right. What? Thanks.
Well, it's just diagrams of something.
Oh,
I mean,
cool.
It's back to ROVing. So,
yeah.
Whether or not, you know, you might just, Charles, you might go ahead and put that on the webpage directly as a post, because I'm not sure.
Well, you can't put unfortunately, you can't put
an
image on the webpage. You can put a link.
Not on the webpage. I mean,
Facebook.
The Seeker group. Yeah.
Yeah, just post it to the Seeker group. I'll find it. And if I don't, then just. You comment with my name in it, or put it underneath this video when this video is actually posted there, and yeah, that'll work.
Okay.
We're done. Thank you guys. Appreciate all the help. Looking forward to the answers. Looking forward to moving on a little bit easier this weekend with this. So, thanks for your input in advance, and we'll be seeing you next week, Saturday 10. Probably some more things. Hopefully, we haven't burned the anything up by then. So for me and Bessie.
Yep.
Tinka. Say goodbye, Tinka. Bye. Take care, guys. Go build something now.